All right then, shall we begin?
Let's go.
Welcome everybody to the Incubate podcast. I prefer to call it Incubate. What do you think?
I don't know. What did we call it before? Super strategy superpowers or something. But I don't know. Incubate's fine. Let's go. Let's have a vote. You vote. Well, you vote. There's only two of us. How are we going to win the vote? Strategy superpowers is our headline at the moment. We're trying to think of something that sort of summarizes what we focus all of our attention on. And it's just definitely, we used to sort of focus on marketing, or we didn't focus on marketing, but we used to use that word. But it's actually strategy, because marketing's just too narrow, you know?
Yeah, it is. That's a good point, isn't it? It's hard to put a label on overall business strategy. But like you say, strategy kind of is more it, isn't it?
Hmm. So do we get some questions? I got a couple from on my Facebook thing here. Did you get any posted?
No, I didn't. Why don't you go ahead and read out what you've got?
All right. I haven't actually read them at all yet, so they might not even be any good.
Hang on. I've got a thought on my mind, Chris. Let me put this to you first.
Go on.
Because just what you said just a moment ago, you know, sometimes I hear people say, like, you know, I've got my product, I've got my service, I've got my website. Now all I need to do is market it. and sometimes I think to myself, yeah, that's the difficult bit, you know?
If only people would come and see what I've got, they would buy it. That's what people say, you know?
Yeah.
Yeah. It's just so really true, though, isn't it? Like your... I even go back to the guitar things that you, the V guitar lessons, which was brilliant. If you had not packaged it in the right way, or done the whole process of, like, maybe you should explain what you used to do to get people to buy your lessons, because it was like everyone's using these sort of funneling tactics now. But back when you did it, nobody was doing it. And maybe it would be useful to explain that process. But I think before you do, my point is, unless you had done it, packaged it and presented it in that way, it wouldn't have mattered how good your V guitar lessons were. They wouldn't have bought it. It's like the marketing and the product are the same thing. I think that's what people miss sometimes.
Yeah, right. And really all that matters when it comes to business is actually service that gets delivered that matters. Like, potential service doesn't mean anything. It doesn't matter if you're talented or you've got skills that could help people. If you don't do the whole thing, the marketing and the sales all the way to delivering that service to that end user, you're not helping anybody with nothing. So it's like, I feel like marketing gets under-respected sometimes, you know?
Mm. I think it gets, I think it gets confused though. So, like, explain your V guitar lesson. So if I remember rightly, you used to do sort of 1 minute or short samples of a lesson. And then basically you would say, and that's how you play the first riff. And now to get the whole song, go to the website and register. Was it something like that?
Yeah, exactly right. So when I started doing my video guitar lessons, it was in the early days of YouTube. It was 2006. I think YouTube had like just come out or was like really new. So what I did, I produced this whole catalogue of guitar lessons where people could choose what song they want to learn. So at the time, it was like Green Day and Red Hot Chili Peppers and whatever was trendy at the time. I had a load of classic rock on there, like Jimi Hendrix, Eric Clapton, Beatles. That was the kind of stuff I was into.
I remember I got my accountant to sign up to it.
Did you?
Yeah.
Oh, wow. Yeah. Oh, cool. Yeah. And you're right. What Chris said was, I used to edit down like a short promo, like teaser video, you know, which was some of the main riffs, just a minute or two so people could see. And then I put that on YouTube. And it was a real simple process, because people would just organically find it on YouTube. And then if it took their interest, they'd go to the website and purchase the full guitar lesson. So real simple, but it worked.
But so my point is that's part of the product and the marketing together. So you could have been the best guitar teacher in the world and recorded videos about it and if you had packaged it in as a DVD and tried to sell it, the same lesson that you sold on YouTube the way that you did, if you tried to sell that on, I don't know, WH Smith's with a DVD, technically it's the same product. It's the same thing. But actually, because of the way that you deliver it and market it, it becomes a completely different product. And that's, I think that's just so underrated with marketing, like thinking through not just how you get the word out to people, but the whole experience of how someone's going to interact with what it is that you're selling, from the point of not knowing you to the point of being a user. That whole process is marketing, like deciding with exact the details of how they're going to start that process. It's not just about how do I get the word out there. That's kind of the last question you should ask.
Yeah, the whole process. Yeah, I completely agree. The whole user experience, the whole customer experience, every step of the way. What are they thinking? What do they want? What concerns do they have? Mm. How are you answering those concerns? It's a whole, you got to loop them up. You got to, anyway. So what was the first question you got?
Oh, I minimized the thing now. I got excited about that.
I stopped myself right at the right moment then, didn't I?
Right, here we go. Topics for your show with Ben tomorrow. Okay, three most ingenious examples of marketing you have seen. Oh my God, that's so difficult. I should have read these before.
Not that.
Let me read. There's three questions. Three common marketing mistakes. And the last one is key ingredients to any campaign. A success. I think any successful campaign. I think she means.
So what's the question?
No, there's three questions, I think. So the first one is three most ingenious examples of marketing you've seen. I don't know I don't think I can give you the three most ingenious, because I think it's more a case of whatever comes to the top of your head. But what have you got? Have you got any ideas of things that you think are just really cool about what people should consider? Well, as a tactic, I think we're talking tactics today.
Well, yeah, I don't know how to answer that question perfectly. But the first thing that jumps to my mind is, you know, you see these like monthly subscription models, like, and I saw one, it was like a gift box, or you get those healthy snack subscriptions, or you get those trendy grease your beard with beeswax subscriptions, or whatever it is for people with hair. And then I saw one, it was like a gift box, and you could basically choose like, you know, three things or five things to go in this gift box, and I don't know, they were a couple of quid each, and like for birthday presents or Mother's Day or whatever, you could just select what stuff your mum would like, and it goes in this gift box. And that was just the first thing that jumped to my mind. I don't know if that answers anything.
Cool. So that's like a product marketing strategy in one, isn't it? So you're basically, the product is the gift, but the marketing strategy is to make it easy to pay for the gifts over a period of time. And I guess there's some sort of reminder system in there as well, probably, that says when you sign up, I guess you put your mum's birthday in and your girlfriend's birthday and your dog's birthday and all that sort of stuff, and it prompts you, I guess. I don't know. So there's two parts to that, I think. That's kind of the marketing thing, and the product are sort of wrapped up into one again. I love it.
Yeah, and I love the flexibility of it, because if you're purchasing a gift for like a guy, there was, you know, men's options and macho stuff, and, you know, men's aftershave and pen knives and what, you know, whatever dudes like. And it was just really flexible. If you're buying for your grandma, there was appropriate stuff. You could just, it was like a pick and mix. Really cool.
So what they've done really well, I don't know who that is, but I already want to sign up to it, because you described a problem I have, right? Birthdays are something I forget until I get reminded, and then I'm like, holy shit, what am I going to do? And it's like the problem is, I want something that reminds me of what to order, or when to be on top of to make sure I always get the right birthday present for someone that I care about. And it's given me some suggestions of the presents, I guess. So that's kind of, it's just a really simple problem I've got, and lots of people have, and it solves it straight away. Whereas Amazon doesn't really solve that problem, does it? Because it's just, although you could buy all those gifts on Amazon, it's not perfectly designed to solve that problem. It's just like any other shop anywhere. I think I think the heart of building a scalable business. I've been thinking about this a lot, and one of the things that we're looking for, and what we look for, what we look to do with businesses, is to find things like that, clear problems that we can solve. We're not in the business of making your local corner shop a little bit better, or the local plumbing business a little bit better than it is at the moment, and helping them make an extra little bit more money. What we're in the business of doing is creating strategies and whole concepts that make a business completely stand out. And like what you just said there is that, isn't it? It's just
so
great.
So you're not looking for just an incremental change. You're not looking to put 5%, on the bottom line. You're looking to sort of rethink and reconfigure and revolutionize the overall strategy entirely.
Yeah, and it doesn't mean that the business has to double or quadruple or anything. It's not about that. It's about, for me, I want the marketing to be easy. So if I'm in a business where I'm struggling to get customers, it's because the only reason I could possibly struggle to get customers, there's only one reason. It's that my product isn't good enough to sell itself. If my product is that good that it needs no explanation, no running around to find new customers, no, you know, it's because if I can do that, so I'm not saying that businesses that don't have that in place shouldn't exist, because there are plenty of decent businesses out there in the world that should just, you know, we've got a good business and maybe we should do a bit better advertising than we're doing at the moment, or we should manage our people better, or we should buy cheaper, or we should sell higher, whatever, you know, the general day-to-day business stuff. There's plenty of businesses where that makes sense. But it's just a bit, it's not what I'm looking to do, and it's not what we're looking to do in our team. What we want is to create, is to take a business and find a new way of doing it and present that business in a way that makes marketing like almost impossible not to work. When you show the product to someone or the service, they go, shit, that's 10 times better than the way I've been getting this done before from another company or without buying anything. So
right.
Does that make sense?
Yeah, you want no-brainer offers. You don't want to be like begging and persuading and hard selling people. You want no-brainer businesses.
Just like the one you just said. I don't know what they're called. Do you know what they're called, that subscription thing?
I can't remember. No, I'll have to have a look it up.
But it's good. I mean, if you've got whatever the monthly fee is and you're prepared to invest that, you know, and you're in that, you're that target market for them, I can't think of a reason why I wouldn't do that. I've not seen the product, but if the solutions are good and the monthly fee is an amount I'm prepared to pay, I can't think of a single reason why I wouldn't do that.
Hey, Chris.
It's brilliant.
I don't know if I'm changing the topic here, but the lady that submitted a question last time we were on the call, and it's one of your businesses that you're involved with, and I can't remember, it was like jelly or gummy or what's it called?
Chewy gem.
Yeah, what is that?
So it's a community of people with SPD, sensory processing difficulties. So generally they've got autism or something connected, so they're on the spectrum, and they find it very difficult often to concentrate and focus on certain things. And basically it started by creating some products that help them just sort of as a fidget, or they were chewing a lot. It started with chewing. It's not chewing just anymore, but they were chewing, especially young adults and kids were going into schools and things and biting their clothes and chewing through them, and end up biting through their skin in some cases. And basically we've created some products, and then we've gone into creating some training and some tools and support network for people who have got some of these challenges. And the people who started the business have got personal family connections and people in their family who basically had these challenges, and it sort of started, the business started to solve those problems, and that's what it is. Yeah.
Oh, so cool.
Now it's a kind of a, now there is a subscription service and a marketplace and a big community, and we've gone from being a product business to basically a community solution business where people come for the community and support from other people and end up basically buying stuff from our marketplace now. So now we have more than just Chewy Gem products and those tools. We've got vendors basically coming into our marketplace and selling things that are useful to our community.
Oh, cool. Yeah, really cool. Have we answered that question fully? I'm not sure.
You said what are three ingenious ways. So the other one I was thinking of was something we've just been testing out here. In Chewy Gem, and we're about to test it in one of the other businesses as well. And that is a referral scheme. So for years, when I was even as an action business coach, what's that noise? Is that me or you?
I'm sorry, I hit the mic accidentally.
Ah, okay. Yeah, so as an action coach, I remember I used to work with like everyday businesses in towns, and we'd look to put referral strategy in place, and it would be a card or something that we would give someone at the end of a service. So my favorite one for that was a windscreen fitting business that I worked with, and in fact, that business was so good. We did two things in that business that basically added I think it was about 40 grand bottom line to his business in about 6 weeks. And this guy was a really lovely guy, like 55 years old, wanting to retire, buy his wife a new car. And he was working so hard. He was making about 40 grand a year. And we added about 45, 50 grand. I'd have to check. I've still got all the records for these things. To his windscreen fitting business in about 4 or 5 weeks, with referrals and with upselling. So the referral was basically after he fitted a new windscreen, these are all insurance jobs, he would give them some cards and say, basically give these to three of your friends. If any of your friends got a chip, just give these cards out in the pub. And if you, if I get one of the cards back, then there was a gift. I can't remember what it was, but it was some sort of voucher for the supermarket. I think it was like beer or wine or something like that. So that was really easy. And that did a bit. But the best thing was the upselling thing. So every time he fitted a windscreen, we just added a little form that the team, there's only three of them, had to give to the customer at the end to sign the job off. So are you happy with the service? Yes. When was the last time you got your windscreen wipers changed? Don't know. When was the last time you filled your water tank up with proper windscreen fluid? Don't know. Would you like it done today? And at least half of the people he did windscreen fittings with just said yes. Didn't ask about the price, didn't ask him anything. So every job he did, he ended up making, I can't remember what it was, but let's say it was an extra, I'd have to look at this up. It was about an extra 55, 60 quid for replacing two windscreen wipers, front and back, filling up the water tank. And I think they gave them something, one of these scraping things for the window up in the ice. And it added about 40 grand to his business, to his bottom line straight away, because it's all profit. I mean, there's no additional work, no additional jobs. Mm. So I love those two.
Fantastic. Yeah, that's fantastic. That actually reminds me of one of my own business activities, you know, the hen parties I do. And they generally choose to book an hour, right, for a life drawing thing for hen parties. But what I started doing, I figured I could add another 3 quid ahead and offer them 75 minutes. And I could, you know, I mean, you know, it's not making me rich, but I figured I can get another 30 or 40 quid out of them just by offering them a little upsell, you know. And it's just money for old rope. I'm going to be there anyway. Yep. It's just a little bit extra for not doing any much more, you know.
Mm-hmm. Yep. There's so many opportunities, especially, so this isn't really strategy changing, but if you've got a business that's running it well, if you look at those small areas where it improves the service to the customer and gives you an opportunity to add a little bit more into the sale, I guarantee that, you know, I've never really found a business where you haven't got half a dozen of those places where you can just sort of tweak the numbers and have a huge impact to the bottom line. Mm. It's all profit. It doesn't, and, it's like, it's just sat there waiting for you. It's all profit.
And a few percent here, a few percent there, they all magnify, don't they? So on the bottom line, that could end up adding a significant amount.
Yeah. So the referral one is referral one. I started off looking at that for our businesses. I didn't finish that part of the story. So now we're adding when new members sign up, just in that sort of onboarding sequence, they get the opportunity to earn a credit. So in one of our stores, you can, instead of using cash, you can use credits, and they get the opportunity to earn a credit, when they refer a friend, and the friend obviously has to sign up and pay something as well. So the reason that's so good is because we know how much it costs us to market to get a new customer. We know it costs us, let's say it's £6 to get a new customer into the store. And we know that the credit value to us is around about the same amount. So this way we're giving the marketing money to the customer instead of to Facebook or Google or whatever. But it's the same for us, it's the same thing. Just things like that. Those are ingenious, I think. What else? I like ingenious things. What else have you seen recently? Have you seen anything recently that have made you go, I have to buy it?
You know what? I know I'm changing topics a little bit, but what I like about you and your thought process is you're looking for sort of simple ways to tweak things that can have a big impact. And it just reminds me, some people, they kind of presume they need to spend a ton of money. Like some people just presume you need to spend a ton of money to get a result, you know, when actually you don't. You can have a shift in thinking, a shift in strategy without spending any money to get a result.
Of course you can. I don't have anything to say about that, really. Just, yeah, yes. I think we've got to, I think on this show, we've got to get some problems to try and solve for people, because it's all very well talking examples. And I think examples like this are useful to sort of get people thinking. But every business is so different, and all of the details and circumstances surrounding the problem will change how you might go about doing it. So I think that should be our next. We have to get some people on here.
Yeah,
Shall I read one of the next questions?
Let me ask you a question first, Chris, because this was on my mind. You know, I used to hang around with loads of hippies all the time. There's loads of like massage therapists, holistic therapists, that kind of thing, you know, reflexology, aromatherapy, Reiki, crystals, tantric massage, you know how it is. what can you do? Because it's one of those things, it's quite competitive, you know, there's a lot of people doing it. What would improve the sales of a massage therapist?
So I think always start in the same place. I think people don't tend to do this because they're scared. We've probably mentioned this before. But you've got to pick a problem that you're prepared to solve. So pick a massage therapist. If you set up a shop in the middle of Bristol that says massage sessions, £80, who are you actually trying to attract into that shop? Are you trying to attract someone who's got a sports injury? Are you trying to attract someone who wants a relaxing spa day? Are you trying to attract a dirty old bloke who wants a happy ending? You know, what's the goal of the business, first of all? And I think, do you see that? What I see when people have marketing problems is they kind of just sort of spread themselves so thinly across a broad spectrum of what they do that they don't end up being anything to anyone.
Yes, I see. Yes, that makes sense.
So I pick, first of all, pick something. So let's imagine they picked, I don't know, what would be a common one? What would be the most common sort of target market for a hippie massage therapist?
Probably would it just be a relaxing thing? Yeah, relaxation, I think, would be the main one, yeah.
Okay, so then you pick a problem, and then you decide, why would someone come to me for that? So is it because I've got the best hands in town? Is it because I've got a special technique? Is it because when people come and see me, they leave feeling happier than they did before or more relaxed? Or what's the thing that's special about me? And if you haven't got one, you've got to find something. Like become focused enough on what's special about you to be able to say it out loud and explain it to someone. So I don't know. I hate massages, and I hate anything like that. So I can't think of any reason why someone would want to have that, someone touch them like that. I don't like to do it. Yeah, get that. No. So it's not a good example for me because I can't think of a good reason why someone would want that. But I'll make something up. It might be right. It might be wrong. Let's say that a reason I wanted to go to a massage was because I got a bad back. Okay. That's probably something common, right? Mm. And so you better get good enough to specifically describe the kind of back pain problem that you specialize in and get good enough to promise, make some sort of promise and guarantee that they will not have that problem after they've been through whatever it is with you. And then massage therapists or most business owners panic at this point. They say, well, I can't promise that they won't have back pain. Well, take the problem and find something that you can promise. So let's say it's back, a lower back pain problem. Specialize in solving lower back pain problems and come up with an offer that means you're so confident in that you think if someone goes through this process with me of 8 weeks or 10 weeks or whatever it is, and they follow all the steps in between, they eat the right things, they drink the right things, they turn up to all the sessions, if they do all of those things, there is no way on earth that they would have their back will not improve. All right, so find your something you can guarantee and then come up with a way of explaining it. So you could then, if you got to that stage, you could say guaranteed back pain, lower back pain relief, coming for a trial session. So if you, as soon as you come up with an offer like that, a marketing offer like that, there's no way that you can put that offer in front of people with lower back pain problems and them not want to come in and try it. Does that make sense?
Yeah, that does make sense.
So marketing is really easy if you come up with an offer that's good enough. And then you say, well, but they're coming in for a free trial. Why would you not? Maybe that's the way to do it. Maybe you charge them. I don't know enough about the massage business to know how the margins work. But if it was me, I guess what I would do is I would get them in for a free trial of half an hour and say, how does that feel? And they say, I feel better already. And I'll say, well, to get my guaranteed program, you're going to have to be with me for 13 weeks. And the 13 weeks course costs £1,000 and there's some payment. You can either pay for it weekly or monthly, but you will get the guarantee that your back will feel better at the end. And also, if you ever need to come back in, you get two extra top-up sessions or whatever. I'll come up with a package to present to them at the end of the trial session. And, you know, if that package is good enough, people will say yes because they want their back to be better. So once you've come up with a whole marketing offer and a sales pitch to go with it, then you've just got to get the offer into the right, in front of the right people. So you just say, where do people with back pains hang out? I guess they go to the doctor, might be in the gym, maybe in the, I've no idea, where do people go who gets back pains? Maybe outside the Bristol box where they've been lifting heavy boxes all day, maybe put a poster outside there. You know, yeah. That's basically it. I can't.
Yeah.
It's not that complicated, really, is it?
Well, it's obvious to you, but not obvious to people that are in the problem. Yeah.
So what? Yeah, that is the thing. So where do people get stuck? Do you think, or with all of this? Because I think it's always easier to solve someone else's problem than it is your own. What's the hippies and the people with these businesses, what are they saying about?
I've never seen a hippie sell a package or promise a result. I've always seen them just approach it on a drop in, you know, if you fancy a massage, you know, here's my number kind of thing.
Yeah. 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 I think it just does need a bit of thinking. You just have to look at the biggest businesses and the best businesses and the most interesting ones in the world and just do what they do. I think, people think that sometimes because someone is bigger or has been around longer or has got a brand that they can't do the same things, that they haven't sort of earned the right to do it, or maybe they're scared of being sued, or I don't know. Maybe it's all this sort of, yeah, I think you've got to decide if you're going to build a business that you don't want to have marketing problems in and you want it to grow itself, you've got to be brave enough to actually commit to delivering a product that's good enough to do that for you.
Yeah, great. I just had another example. Like, can I throw another example at you?
Yeah, go for it. I've got about 10 more minutes.
Okay. Would you rather like get to the notes that you got in front of you then in that case?
The no, go for it. You ask the question.
Okay, well, it's pretty similar. I'm just thinking of an old friend, a guy, a housemate actually that I used to live with, and he was like basically a psychotherapist, and he, not exactly a hypnotherapist, but like a counselor kind of thing. And he would work with people online over Skype, and he specialized in a few niches such as anxiety, and he specialized in pain, like pain management, like the psychology side of pain management. And I think he had like a couple of other niches, things like that. But and now what am I asking you? I'm not quite sure. He was always grappling with his marketing. How do I get new clients? Should I pay for Google ads? And I think he had some results with paying for Google ads, and he was always trying to decide what kind of package to offer, how much. He was always nervous about increasing his prices, and I'm not sure what I'm asking you, Chris, exactly, but do you have any
I
thoughts?
think I yeah I do. I think what I'm hearing you say is he's gone down the route, but I hear this as well. I've got a niche. I've got a really clear problem I've solved, and it sounds like that he had some customers, and when he does some marketing, it worked, or it worked to a degree, and then I think the biggest challenge, I think him maybe, but people like him I see often, especially when they're starting, is they get stuck in this one man band loop, which is either it's basically do the work, get the work, do the work, get the work. And when they're doing the work and they're busy, they're saying, oh man, I got no time, I'm so busy. And then they've got no work and they say, shit, I need to do some marketing. And they don't actually ever get to the stage where they've balanced those two things so that they're consistently busy. And so I have this at the moment with some challenge. There's a business that we're getting involved with at the moment, and there's partners, and basically the marketing strategy and the campaign that we've put together, and the niche of the business is working so well. It's so predictable. Cost per leads have come down 30%, something like that, in the last couple of months. Bookings are up, and basically we're at the stage now where we can effectively take as many new clients on as we want, because it's the marketing is that predictable. We spend X, we get X, right? So the challenge now is for the team members who have basically their part, that they have to invest in their own marketing in this business, is some of them are not investing enough. And they're not busy enough, but they're not investing enough. And the numbers are there to prove the model works, but they, in their head, they are battling constantly with overcomplicating this process of running a business. Invest some money in marketing, get a customer, repeat. And I think when you're a one-man band, because you've got so many things to deal with, my life is a lot easier now. I've got a team around me of people doing stuff than it was when I was working by myself. Even though the business is way more complicated and there's so many different moving parts, there are people in the business who take care of everything. I don't need to be in the office for day-to-day stuff to happen. But I remember being in the position where I did, and that's, I think, more of the problem than the actual marketing itself. Now, once you've found that strategy, it's logically it's just a case of copy and paste and repeat, and just keep make sure it keeps working. I think the challenge is getting yourself into a position where you're brave enough and committed enough, and you've got all of the other stuff around you sort of covered, so that you can commit to actually investing the money to go to the next level. Otherwise, you'll be stuck in this cycle forever. You have to invest in making those things happen, because you'll never be able to do it. It doesn't matter whether you're Gary V or and you're hustling 23 hours a day, and whatever it is, there's only so many hours in a day, and you have to at some stage invest in the business to be able to get out of this loop where it's marketing or delivery type of situation. You have to be able to constantly have both of those things working to grow.
Yeah, I get you. Yeah, that makes sense. Also, another thought that just occurred to me with you talking is a lot of times when you learn something new, whether it's business or learning anything else, it's often a process of demystifying and simplifying. Because, like, the vibe that I get from you is like, look, this is simple. There's simple principles. If you do X, Y, Z, A, B, C, you're going to, increase your sales kind of thing. And, you know, I see the same like with what I do with handstands. A lot of time people come and they're expecting that things are complicated and difficult and there's 100 things and they need to squeeze this muscle and put this finger here and look in this direction. And it's not like that at all. I find myself actually demystifying handstand. And I used to do the same with guitar. I demystify it. And I hear you doing the same with business. It's like you're teaching people, no, look, this is simple. You're overcomplicating it.
Mm. I think I don't like the expression. It's simple, but it's not easy. But it's true in this case. I do it in my own life, in my own businesses, every day, every week. Have you ever read The E-Myth by Michael Gerber?
Yeah, I listen to the audio, but yeah.
Yeah, in the audiobook, that's what the audiobook he says. Most entrepreneurs go through a depression. I go through one pretty much every morning. Do you remember that bit? And I'm like, that's me. Like, honestly, once a day, maybe I'm exaggerating, once a week at least, I reckon I go into a spiraling, depressive state about how things are shit. And then I find a way to build it all back together again, and life's good again. And I can do that a couple of times a day, and I'm sure you can too. Like, anyone who's in business that's good at it has learned that cycle. So it's not that no one suffers from it, but I think if you can get good at bouncing back and going back to focusing on the problem at hand and figuring out just a simple solution to what's in front of you there, then it isn't more complicated than that. Maybe there's more to it. Maybe the problem with podcasts like this and talking about things like this anyone can give the answers like this, but actually the problem is what is getting someone to do it and getting someone in a state of mind where they're able to act on simple stuff like this.
Do you spend a lot of your time when you work with people on their psychology side of things? Because with Alex, she's heavily like, everything I've done with Alex so far is like 80-90% psychology, and we haven't even started talking about property yet.
Yeah, that's why I stopped being a business coach, because I found myself spending 99-95% whatever, like almost all my time dealing with people getting out their own way, just sort of getting them to the point stage where they could take action on the tactic, on the plan that had already been put together. So I got into my own business. It's not gone away. I mean, I deal with it myself every day. I have to look in the mirror and give myself a good talking to. I have people who coach me to keep me on track. I've got the managers and the CEOs in the businesses are having those challenges, but it's a bit easier for me as being a partner in a business to get things to happen than it is as a coach on the outside. And maybe that's just my level of coaching skills rather than any a reflection or anything else. But yeah, like, everything is all about people.
Yeah.
Shit. I mean, that's every problem in the world comes. I can't think of it, unless you're talking about scientific, like, we can't get enough energy out of a battery type problems. All the problems in the world really are people problems.
Yeah, limiting factor is beliefs and psychology most of the time, isn't it, I would think. And like, sometimes when I think to myself, you know, like, it's difficult enough to be successful in life when you're genuinely want to accomplish it, but as soon as you got like, oh, money's bad, rich people are greedy, anti-capitalist, blah blah, as soon as you got all that going on, oh man, you're fucked. Yeah. How's anything ever gonna happen, you know?
How could you be happy in life? People make their life so complicated, and even like I do too. I'm not saying see, it's hard to talk about that. See, I imagine how complicated I make my life when I hear what other people are going on. Fucking hell. I feel like my life is complicated sometimes, but it's compared to most, what you, like the group of people you just described, it's a breeze.
right. How are you doing for time, Chris? Do you need to get going?
I have to go and I have to go and get the children, and that sort of stuff. It's Friday afternoon here. What do you like? What do you think of our new meeting room?
I was just going to say it looks fantastic. I love you've got woods aesthetic on the wall, and you've got some LED backlighting above it. Is it?
Yeah. We've built something over there, not a door.
Wow.
And then, yeah, it's cool, isn't it?
Where are you right now?
That's in the meeting room in the office.
Yeah, which city are you in?
I'm in Grünstadt. It's a tiny, tiny place on the Weinstraße, on the Wine Street in Germany. So we're about an hour south of Frankfurt. It's where I live and basically where I've built our core office. We've got about 8 people. This is our co-working office. So we've got about 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, about 8 of our own team here and people who come in to do co-working and use the office as well. So we've got it's pretty much full now, and so hopefully if all goes well we'll get a new site, which I'll show you one day, which is over there.
Right, nice one. That's really cool, really impressive. It's really cool what you're doing.
Cool. Hopefully we'll have some new offices coming, some new co-working offices coming into the UK by the end of the year. But
yeah,
we'll plan that later.
Yeah, wonderful. Cool. All right, Chris. So we'll speak next week, and people can submit their questions as always. And if anybody wants to come on the podcast, we can facilitate that like a call-in show.
Yeah, let's invite some. Let's follow our own advice and get some specifics. So, I think someone who's got a startup idea, so they haven't launched yet, and they want to talk about launching and the best way to do it. Could be any industry. So maybe come on with your question, or submit it in as a text. And then what would be another cool one to talk to? Something else to get people thinking about specifics. A bricks and mortar type business where you're dealing with people in a local town, so not like a manufacturing business or an online business, but something where you're actually working in a local town where you're dealing with local customers and you're trying to get local customers in, something like that. Any businesses that you know with who would like to grow and have got some questions or would like some input on how to they scale, tag them, ask them to submit a question to us for next week. Is that all right?
Perfect. Yeah. Let's do that.
Cool. All right.
See
you later.
Okay. Bye, Chris.